people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. It's been a year since the deadly COVID-19 was declared a pandemic by the WHO. From a little over 100,000 cases then, the caseload stands close to 117 million infections today. Not to forget, over 2.7 million people have died. The counter and cure, the COVID vaccine is out and around 330 million doses have been administered so far. But who is at the forefront in this war? India. Yes, dubbed as the pharmacy of the world, India is providing the silver bullet to the world. Over 58 million doses across 65 countries have been transported under its Vaccine Maitri initiative. The world has heaped praises on its efforts and look forward to getting more support and vaccines in the road ahead.
This COVID consignment being unloaded here in Ethiopia has arrived from India. The country is expected to receive 2.2 million India-made vaccines in the next few weeks under the COVAX initiative. Like Ethiopia, 64 other countries have so far received over 58 million India-made doses in past 1.5 months, with the country set to produce and distribute tens of millions more in the coming months. India is rolling out its vaccines for more than 25 countries under the COVAX initiative.
And this event today symbolizes what I call global solidarity and global cooperation. It also symbolizes the bridging of the gap in inequities across the world. We have always said at the start of this pandemic that we needed global cooperation, global solidarity, global coordination to achieve the target. And the target is simple, to defeat COVID from everywhere in the world, because we recognize that a COVID threat anywhere in the world is a COVID threat everywhere in the world.
While India launched its domestic immunization program on 16 January, its global assistance mission kicked off just 4 days later, with countries in its immediate neighborhood receiving the first tranches of vaccine doses. New Delhi has also adhered to its principle of humanity before commerce, with many of them receiving hundreds of thousands of vaccines free of cost. While India has committed to immunizing 200,000 UN peacekeepers, it will also be proactively supporting the United Nations in vaccinating Syria, where the virus has compounded the crisis.
Under the initiative of Vaccine Maitri, which translates into vaccine friendship, India provides vaccines to the world. We are, of course, a significant source of supply to the COVAX facility. But in addition, India is also directly sending vaccines to our friends and partners, starting with our immediate neighbors. 25 nations across the world have already received Made in India vaccines. 49 more countries will be supplied in the coming days, ranging from Europe, North America, Latin America, the Caribbean, to Africa, Southeast Asia, and the Pacific Islands. Keeping in mind the UN peacekeepers who operate in such difficult circumstances, we would like to announce today a gift of 200,000 doses for them as well.
From international groupings to individual leaders, all have appreciated New Delhi's endeavors in strengthening the global fight of keeping corona at bay. While India continues to assist the world, it has been steadily expanding its vaccination drive at home. At least 20 million people have already received at least one jab, with a total tally going past 25 million. The Government of India has also negotiated with vaccine manufacturer, the Serum Institute of India, to further reduce the price that was earlier capped at $2.75 per dose.
We have renegotiated the price. The renegotiated price is significantly lower than 200 rupees per dose.
India has reiterated its commitment towards entire humanity and not just the Indians. And the actions in the last few weeks have vividly demonstrated its will. While a few rich countries are planning to hoard billions of doses, India has provided the vaccine to the poorest at a reasonable cost. While experts and leaders have called it a real defender of humanity, it is beginning to appear that they have not been exaggerative in their analysis and praises.
Moving on. Weeks of stalled Afghan peace talks have only added to the uncertainty and complexity. As 1st May 2021, the day which is supposed to mark the complete withdrawal of US forces from the war-torn country nears, the new Washington dispensation has called for an interim administration in Kabul until a new constitution is agreed upon and elections held. The US has also proposed a UN-led multilateral engagement to achieve stability. President Ghani says he is ready to go ahead with all that it takes to secure peace, provided the course chosen is fair and democratic.
President Ashraf Ghani, in another peace overture aimed at providing level field to the Taliban insurgents, has said that his government is ready to discuss holding fresh elections, given the process followed is democratic. His announcement comes in the wake of the US calling for the setting up of an interim government in Kabul, followed by inclusive elections. Washington has also proposed a unified UN-led multilateral approach to achieve peace.
که در مورد برگزاری انتخابات آزاد، شفاف و سرتاسری تحت مدیریت جامعه جهانی بحث کنیم. در مورد تاریخ برگزاری انتخابات هم می توانیم صحبت کنیم و به نتیجه برسیم.
The Afghan peace process has largely remained stalled this season after both Kabul and the Taliban remained adamant on positions. While Ghani administration, which has released 4,400 Taliban prisoners in the line of last year's agreement, denied releasing 600 Taliban prisoners, citing them extremely dangerous. The insurgent group too has not shown any intent at scaling down violence. Now Washington, which is still reviewing last year's deal, finds itself in a quandary of uncertainty. However, a letter written to the head of Afghan government by US Secretary of State this week did not outline any change in plan. The US has proposed an UN-led meeting, including the shareholders from the region, that are Russia, China, Pakistan, Iran, India, and the US, to discuss a unified approach. While Turkey has been asked to host senior-level meetings, the US has urged its envoy to remain transparent with both sides. While the US says it has not ruled out May 1st withdrawal, a 90-day violence reduction plan to prevent a spring offensive by the Taliban has also been prepared. The United States seeks acceleration and its man on the ground, Zalmay Khalilzad, is reaching out to all parties. The US says it has been pursuing an approach that leads to an inclusive transition of power and the return of peace. Elected 2 years ago, President Khadi, who is not yet midway through his five-year term, says he is ready to commit all forms of exercise until they are democratic in nature.
به کسانی که برای رسیدن به قدرت به این و آن دروازه می روند برادرانه توصیه می کنم که اقتدار سیاسی در افغانستان یک دروازه و یک کلید دارد و آن رای آزاد مردم افغانستان است.
While everything is appear meticulous on paper, the real challenge seems to have unfolded now, with the ball lying in the Taliban's court. Violence and targeted killings have surged, and Western security officials say the insurgents, already holding large swathes of rural areas, have begun to gain ground around towns and cities. The Taliban have not yet committed to peace. The US might withdraw in under 2 months. Pakistan, which has been accused of covertly supporting violence in Afghanistan, has not amended its stance. China, which is said to have made deep economic footprints in Afghanistan, might trounce on the opportunity. Russia and other powers have not revealed their cards yet. Under such circumstances, one can only wait for things to unwind and hope for a peaceful conclusion of the process that is walking the final segment of a tightrope.
Moving on, people in Sri Lanka are frustrated with the fact that even a high-level investigation into 2019 Easter Sunday bombings couldn't find the real perpetrator of the attacks that claimed nearly 270 lives. A large number of them recently held silent demonstrations outside churches in Colombo and asked for justice from the government. While observing the Black Sunday, people said only the prosecution of masterminds will give justice to their dear ones who died in the attacks.
Parishioners of Catholic churches from across the island nation of Sri Lanka attended Sunday services in black. They observed Black Sunday, demanding justice for the victims of the 2019 Easter Sunday suicide bomb attacks, which killed more than 267 people and injured nearly 500. They said the colour will signify their anger. Bishops are of the view that government has failed in ensuring justice even after 2 years of mayhem in which three churches and three hotels were targeted by Islamic extremist suicide killers. They also recited special prayer after Sunday mass calling for justice on their behalf.
Today, the Catholic Church has come together for a silent protest, and we have all started a campaign called the Black Sunday campaign, which will continue till the 21st of April. It's been 2 years since the Easter attack, and there is absolutely no sign of justice being done. So all we are asking today is for justice to be enforced.
After admitting to laxity shown by the system, the Sri Lankan administration, led by the then president Maithripala Sirisena, had set up an inquiry commission into the attacks. However, the report that was submitted to the parliament last month has blamed him only. Other senior members too, it said, should face the charges for not acting to prevent the attack. It is pertinent to mention here that the commission functioned and investigated largely in the tenure of Rajapaksa brothers, who have been accused of witch hunting opposition. The people of Sri Lanka, however, do not have such an agenda, as all they are asking for is justice. Catholic leader Cardinal Malcolm Ranjit recently cautioned authorities if they failed to come up with answers as to who was behind the attacks by the second anniversary of the bombings, then he, along with thousands of others, will call for a nationwide Black Flag campaign. The campaign would involve Sri Lankans flying a black flag above their homes as a sign of protest. Commoners have backed him.
Wasra deka gut ikutila, kisima sahara nekne, apegi nyati saudario desi gana akali megia, tawat sahena gutsa anggavikarela, utpalela inwa, et kisima sahara tiak ituela ne.
The Easter Sunday bombings in the country was one of the single worst terrorist attacks in South Asia. National Tawheed Jamaat, a local Islamist group, had been blamed for the attack. However, observers accused that the case was not followed with the seriousness and dedication it demanded. In January this year, the U.S. Justice Department charged three Sri Lankans with supporting terrorism for their alleged participation in the attacks. All three are in custody in Sri Lanka but have not been charged locally. People say the simmering anger will burst if the government doesn't find the perpetrators now. The government for now appears clueless as to what is to be done in the case that has already been closed by the investigating agencies.
Ever since Pakistan illegally occupied a part of the then princely state of Jammu and Kashmir, it has been committing numerous atrocities on the people of this region. Their lands have been snatched, their natural resources plundered, and adding more to their worries, even their political leaders work in cahoots with Islamabad. With no light at the end of the tunnel, the life of people living in these illegally occupied territories is slowly getting pushed towards complete darkness.
Pakistan-occupied Kashmir and Gilgit-Baltistan, which remains under the illegal occupation of Pakistan for more than 72 years, are being treated as colonies. The grip of an occupier is getting stronger, with rights activists meeting a brutal state crackdown or ending up in prison. Indiscriminate plunder of natural resources by Islamabad has been highlighted repeatedly, but that hasn't been enough to deter it. Activists say that the region is not even granted a small share of dividends generated from its resources.
Our water resources are used, but we are completely ignored in any kind of royalty in this Nelam and Jhelum hydro projects. So Azad Kashmir is a colony, simply. And all those officials who were installed, who are installed in Azad Kashmir, they are playing in the hands of GOC Murray, and they are serving Pakistan's sovereign interest. They are not serving the people of Azad Jammu and Kashmir's interest.
Pakistan falsely claims to have granted autonomy to the region. Locals call it an absolute joke. Even the Prime Minister and the President of the occupied POK have no say in the policy making for Kashmir. In fact, they are there to execute orders of Islamabad-installed Lent officers. The so-called Independent Legislative Assembly is not allowed to prepare even one document on its own. It must have the approval and blessings of Islamabad.
All the powers, constitutionally, all the powers is in the hand of four powerful lent officers. The Prime Minister and President have no constitutionally any rights to serve the peoples. And that constitution, that act is imposed by the government of Pakistan, and the so-called Legislative Assembly has no right to amend or to delete or to add anything which is benefits for the Kashmiri people.
In Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, anyone who wants to serve as a public servant is asked to sign a pledge of loyalty to Pakistan. Even the establishment has used draconian legislation to frame or suppress the voice of anybody who has dissented or has gone against the late protocols. And with no legal recourse available to these hapless people, an assertive international intervention is the only way they can be saved from an imminent doom.
Moving on. Each festival in India pertains to different occasions. While some welcome the seasons of the year, others promote sports in the country. However, all the festivals come with the promise of joy and are a reminder of the country's cultural heritage. Recently, a grand traditional buffalo race festival drew hundreds of people to India's southern Bengaluru city. Over 150 pairs of buffaloes took part in the annual event, which is usually marked by the end of the harvest season in the region. Have a look.
The southern state of Karnataka is famous for several sporting festivals, which include animal racing. One such festival is Kambala Buffalo Race, which was recently organized in India's Bengaluru city with enthusiasm and fervor. The festival involves the traditional buffalo race, a popular and unique sport among the farming community of the Indian state. It is believed that the festival is dedicated to Lord Kadri Manjunatha, an incarnation of Lord Shiva, and it is celebrated to please the god for a good harvest. Over 150 pairs of buffaloes participated in the race. The race usually marks the end of the harvest season in the region. It is popular among rural masses and generally takes place in wet rice fields. For young participants, the race becomes a show of strength and valor.
There is a matter of prestige more than anything else. It is matter of prestige, it is matter of tradition, it is matter of culture for us. That is why this Kambala is getting this sort of a support.
For the race, the chosen buffaloes undergo rigorous training and are fed on a special diet. On the day of the festival, the buffaloes are made to wear decorative and colorful headgears made of brass and silver, sometimes bearing the emblems of the sun and moon, and ropes are tied as a bridle. The special cloth used to cover the buffalo's back is called pavadi. People bet on buffaloes. One can witness more than 20,000 spectators in well-organized Kambala egging on and cheering the buffaloes to complete the race. The winning pair is rewarded a cash prize and coconuts, but traditionally, it was a non-competitive sport in which buffaloes run in the field one by one.
In Mangalore city, for the last 4 years, we, a team of youngsters, have been organizing this. Our primary intention has been that a lot of people from different parts of the state, different parts of the country, today come to Mangalore. We should exhibit our tradition, culture and sport to them. That is the reason we have organized this Kambala for the last 4 years, and it has been successful in all ways.
The word Kambala is derived from Kampa Kala, the word Kampa, which signifies slushy, muddy field. Every year, farmers from across the country participate in the race festival. Last year, Srinivasa Gowda, a farmer, had a record-breaking win that made him an overnight sensation. According to the beliefs, Kambala is a festival that originated in the farming community of Karnataka, and it attracts huge crowds of sports and adventure enthusiasts, both from India and abroad alike.
Kambala has been drawing a large number of people from 300 years. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.